not a doctor issue. All right, so for this gentleman, by the way, with the RDEB and his son, look for digestive problems. Look for foods that are causing inflammation. RDEB is specifically associated with an enzyme that builds up in response to dirt, in response to defects. It's called collagenase. Collagenase. Remember, whenever you hear the word ace or the ending of a word ace, you have an enzyme. Collagenase is an enzyme that eats up collagen. And it only eats up collagen when the collagen is defective. And the collagen is defective when there's inflammation. So for this kid with this RDEB, recessive dystrophic epidermolysis bullae, look for digestive issues. Use digestive support. Use the BioLumen Nightly Essence. Make sure you're on the healthy start pack so you're getting your Mighty 90 essential nutrients. Make sure you're pounding the essential fats with foods. Reducing sugar intake and any kind of inflammatory food, reducing it all, sugar counts. Practicing deep breathing techniques and moving the body around. Same thing if he had arthritis, and RDEB is nothing more than arthritis of the epidermis. Okay, I'm Pharmacist Ben. You're listening to The Bright Side. Time to hit our phones. Let's go to Chuck in Idaho. What's going on, Chuck? Welcome to The Bright Side. You've been holding on forever. Chuck.
This is Chuck. How you doing?
What's up, Chuck? How you doing, man?
I'm doing great. Hey, man, I've got so much I'd like to talk to you about. So to be fair to the other callers, I'll cut it down to one question.
Okay.
Well, first of all, is mayonnaise qualify for what you just said about ending in AISC?
No, that's that would be mayonnaise, smart aleck. It's mayonnaise.
So you got me there.
Okay. All right, funny boy.
Know, I've been weaning off of Synthroid and Armor.
Yeah? How you feeling?
Excuse me?
How are you doing? How you feeling?
I'm feeling great, and that's what I'm asking you. That's what I'm calling about. I wanted to know, I cut my dosage in half. Exactly in half, and it's been over 30 days now that I still feel totally fine.
Now, praise God. So, I can't tell you how many times I hear that. People just get thrown on these drugs. And by the way, Synthroid and Thyroid are the best-selling drugs in America, among the best-selling drugs in America. I think they're number one this year. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
That's okay. So now, whenever I would go to the doc and get blood tests and do the numbers thing, he would always wait 2 or 3 months whenever we would make an adjustment on the dose.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering if that's really necessary. After 30 days...
Nobody knows what they're doing, Chuck. They don't understand. They're just throwing stuff against the wall and see what sticks, period. When you have a hypothyroid, this is the problem with the thyroid, with treatment for the thyroid. If you have a thyroid problem, you don't have a thyroid hormone problem. That's a symptom. The problem is in the gland. Do you follow me? And so replacing the hormone without fixing the gland doesn't help you, because now the body's got this foreign hormone that it has to figure out how to deal with, and that's why your dose has to keep changing. Hang on, Chuck. I'm going to finish up when we come back from our break. We got Elena George coming up at the bottom of the hour. Sorry if we left you on hold. Give us a call back on our next program. Tell our call screener we left you on, and we'll get you first up. We'll be back right after this. Don't go away. All right, we are back on The Bright Side. I'm Pharmacist Ben. We're on the air Monday through Friday, 8 to 9 Pacific and 10 to 11 Central Time, 24/7 on our archive page at brightsideben.com. Got 4+ years of archives, lots of archives, lots of good health information at brightsideben.com. Also, benfuchsarchives.com, and both pages have search engines. You can also go to my blog, pharmacistben.com, or criticalhealthnews.com. And if you're interested in purchasing any of the Truth products, Truth Skin Health products, including our retinol 5% gel, go to truthtreatments.com. Okay, I am excited to talk to our next guest. Elena George is a physician, an MD, an ear, nose, and throat physician, otolaryngologist, as they say, from Princeton University. She's written a book called Big Medicine, The Cost of Corporate Control and How Doctors and Patients Working Together Can Rebuild a Better System. So I see two parts there. I see the cost of corporate control, and then I see part two, how doctors and patients working together can rebuild a better system. And those are two separate ideas that I want to talk about with Dr. Elena George. Welcome to The Bright Side, Dr. George.
Thank you so much for having me on.
Thank you for wanting to be on. So I love the title of the book, first of all, Big Medicine, because we always hear about big pharma, but we don't really hear a lot about big medicine, right?
No, we don't, and they're all integrated. There's been an absolute shift in what medicine is now. It used to be patient-centered. Doctor-patient relationship was the key. That's been shifted to corporate interests, and we're all suffering because of it.
Isn't it interesting how when you go to these HMO places, how we the doctor's not there for us anymore? It's been shifted. The doctor's, he works for Kaiser now.
Absolutely so, right.
Right?
An independent doctor has a fiduciary responsibility and an accountability to the patient. When they become employees of hospitals and these systems, they're answering to the board and to the corporate drivers of the healthcare. It's a problem.
That's a very underappreciated shift, but a very, very important shift. Your doctor is no longer working for you. He's working for a corporation whose bottom, who legally, like you say, doctor, is a fiduciary obligation. Legally, they have to be concerned with the bottom line, right? It's a, you know, there's a fiduciary obligation to be to honor the bottom line.
It actually comes down to algorithms at this point. If doctors don't follow what is driven by the electronic medical record, they can't even close the chart. And if you keep going outside of it, you become a disruptive doctor, and you're on the hook for sham peer review, which they can remove you from the hospital setting. You may never practice again.
You know, that is unbelievable. And here's the thing, Dr. George, there's some docs who are, you know, as time moves on, younger and younger doctors graduate and older doctors leave. And eventually there's a shifting over into a citizenry, a doctor citizenry or a doctor population, if you will, that is doesn't know any different. That doesn't even remember a time when the doctor, you know, worked for the patient or was an independent doctor. He went to the doctor's office and it was a real office, his own office or even house calls. You know, more and more doctors have forgotten that. And that's how that happens in a lot of venues. But in the medical venue, there's a lot of young doctors who don't know any different than Kaiser and HMOs, correct?
You make an excellent point. There's been a change in the medical education. The Hippocratic Oath itself has actually changed. When I took mine, I was not allowed to do, still am, because it matters to me, not allowed to do any harm. I have to be an advocate for my patient. I can't, cause euthanasia. I can't perform abortions. That's the oath I took. The new one is completely different.
They modernized it?
That's correct. And they actually allow people to perform euthanasia in the new Hippocratic Oath. So it's completely opposite to what people actually think. And
what
that's a tragedy.
They edited. I didn't know this. They edited Hippocratic. Oh my God! Is nothing sacred?
No. If you read my book, it's actually. I give you an example of the old Hippocratic Oath, the classic one, and the new one that's taken.
I'm looking at your book right now. I thought doctors weren't. They didn't take the Hippocratic Oath any longer.
Well, I did. It's a pretty much a UN version of it.
So
globalized.
They change a lot of people don't realize, but it says, I will do no useless, I'm going by memory here, I will do no useless surgery and I will prescribe no poison, right?
That's correct.
That's part of the Hippocratic Oath.
That's correct.
Did they leave that in there?
It's kind of a neurolinguistic version of it. So, apply for the benefit of the sick, all measures that are required.
Avoid
the twin traps, overtreatment and therapeutic nihilism. Whatever that means.
They use the word therapeutic nihilism?
Yeah.
How interesting is that? Like everything's useless? What? Like we can't, what does nihilism mean? There's nothing, it's not worth doing anything? How do you have therapeutic nihilism? It's an oxymoron, no?
I agree with you. That's why it's nonsense. It allows people to actually talk about end of life decisions instead of actually trying to help the patient and pushing people into a hospice track. I mean, it's not about health care. The Affordable Care Act was about control.
Absolutely.
Control of 1/6 of the economy, control of patient choices. I mean, I'm all about individuality and independence. And if people choose a natural method of treatment, I'm all for that. But in this system, it's being negated and it's being demonized. And they are systematically removing doctors who actually want to help people, who actually want to get them better. It's all about giving you a drug at this point and putting you on a track. And if you're too expensive, make you comfortable.
How about the idea of co-opting the alternative strategies with, for example, I'm thinking about there's these essential fatty acid drugs. Have you heard about these? This thing called Coreguard, which is like fish oil, but it's a prescription and costs you $100 a bottle.
Yeah. Well, it's actually a scam by the pharmaceutical industry, isn't it? They take what's natural. They make it somehow. They try to co-opt it, make it, trademark it.
They patent it. Yeah,
and
put a little ester on it.
It costs you 10 times more.
Agreed. How do you like that?
I don't. And that's the problem. And more doctors actually need to speak up about that.
Now, are you seeing patients, Dr. George, or are you at this point a troublemaker? I'm saying that
in
a kind way.
I see patients. I'm actually talking with you now in my lunch hour. I love what I do. I'm a doctor. I see patients every day. And I'm proud to say that I'm an independent doctor. I'm not on the payroll of any hospital. I take care of my own patients. And my responsibility is to follow the Hippocratic Oath. And that's why I wrote the book. I wanted people to understand, finally, from a doctor's perspective who practiced, why it broke, who are the players who broke it, and more importantly, how you get around this system.
Now, I have a lot of friends who are physicians. I've been a pharmacist for 30 years. So, you know, for the most part, the individuals who are physicians are good people. They want to help. Mm-hmm. They want to make a difference. And I'm somewhat guilty of beating up on the profession. I don't know if, you know, you've probably listened to my program a little bit. So, you know, I'm kind of guilty of it. And I know doctors are demonized in a certain part of the alternative marketplace, if you will. How do you feel about that as a physician? Are you embarrassed or do you want to, what's your take on it as a physician, as a member of this kind of profession that has done so much, has misled people, even though the individuals are kind, as right. The profession that has misled people so much. How do you feel about that personally?
Well, I personally think it's been hijacked by corporate interests, and I think that our AMA has sold a bill of goods to doctors and patients, and they don't work for us anymore. They're actually in bed with the corporate interests. That's what the coding system's all about. That's what demonizing supplements are all about. And, you know, there's lots of ways to treat patients. I think that we should be given the freedom as physicians and patients to choose what's best for us instead of some, you know, big brother telling us you can only do it this way and mm-hmm. it's better. If it's not part of the system, we can't make money on you, then we're going to demonize it. I'm smart enough to know the difference. And I think there's a growing number of doctors who think that way, too.
Dr. George, we've got to take a break. When we come back, I want to talk to you about the second part of your subtitle, How Doctors and Patients Working Together Can Rebuild a Better System. We're talking to Dr. Elena George. Her book is Big Medicine. We'll be back on The Bright Side right after this. Don't go away. Okay, we are back on The Bright Side talking to Dr. Elena George about her book, Big Medicine. Doc, before I forget, give out your website real quick, and how can people get a hold of you if they want to talk to you more or get more information about what you're talking about?
You can go to drelainageorge.com. That's E-L-A-I-N-A, George like the man's name, .com. I've been writing this for about 4 years or 5 years now. So there are also blogs and some links that I think people will find really helpful.
What is your blog website?
It's the same thing, drelainageorge.com.
Oh, okay, got it. Drelainageorge.com. So everything's on drelainageorge.com.
That's correct, even how to get the book.
Okay, good deal. All right, so the second, your subtitle is The Cost of Corporate Control and How Doctors and Patients Working Together Can Rebuild a Better System. So I want to talk about that second part because it's very interesting. I find the idea that doctors and patients can work together very intriguing, and I want to get to that. But before we do, you talk about rationing, this idea of rationing, and I don't think people really understand what that means and the implications of that. And then you mention socialized medicine. And then you link them to Obamacare. So I'd like you to take just a moment and talk about the problem of rationing and what that really is and the implications of rationing. And then what exactly you mean when you say socialized medicine and how these two things are connected to the so-called Affordable Care Act or Obamacare.
Well, rationing comes in two sections, if you want to put it that way. There's the insurance company's view of rationing, where they want you to pay a premium and then deny you care after the fact. They've been masterful at doing that, and they've right. doubled down on that in Affordable Care Act. Then there's the soft side of it, and that's patients self-rationing because they don't have enough money to actually come to the physician or actually get the services they need because their out-of-pocket costs are so high. When I opened my practice in 2001, people would, if they had insurance, paid nothing. They just, you know, present their card, and it was all covered. They're now coming in having to pay upwards of $10,000 out-of-pocket before the insurance kicks in the first dime. Mind you, they're paying their premiums right along, you know, $12,000, $25,000 for a family, and then they're on the hook for up to $10,000 more. They don't tell you this. And ultimately, people were hoodwinked into thinking that having health insurance equals access to quality health care. I can tell you that it's not equal. You can carry a piece of plastic, but it doesn't mean you're going to be able to see a doctor. And if you do see one that works for you instead of against you. Doctors are now agents of the government in this new system. The Affordable Care Act has something called meaningful use, where we're forced, if we choose to, take Medicare, forced to ask questions like, do you have a gun in your home? Have you ever tried to hurt yourself? How many people live at home? pediatricians have to ask if your child thinks he's a boy or a girl. Let me tell you, this is a metadata system. They are